How to financially exploit children. What you need to do is create a monster card game like Yu-Gi-Oh! Then you have to give each Yu-Gi-Oh! Card monetary value through various levels of artificial scarcity. For example, you might employ concepts like a rare card. The rarity has nothing to do with the cost of producing the things. They are, after all, just ink on paper. No, you simply, by choice, manufacture less copies of some cards than others. In economics, when there is less of something, it has more value. Simply by printing less of certain cards, you can use it as an excuse to raise the prices of those cards that are labeled rare. You need to also create an emotionally engaging anime about the card game, where a character who is depicted as a pipsqueak transforms into a brave and confident character of an ancient Egyptian pharaoh every time he plays this card game. This will resonate with the bitch-ass nerds who are weak in real life, both mentally and physically, and can only have any hope of kicking someone's ass in a card game. Specifically, a monster card game. I'm not talking about poker or something like that. This isn't just about money, however. This is also about inflicting psychological distress for sadistic reasons. Every week, a new episode of Yu-Gi-Oh! Will come out where a new rare card is introduced. You would see that back then some individual cards would be sold up to $100 on Amazon. Imagine paying that much for a rectangle of cardboard with ink on it. The parents of some children will be poor, while the parents of others will be rich. The Federal Reserve will ensure that almost everyone but the Bavarian Illuminati and other tribe members are poor. Perhaps a poor child is friends with a child who has a parent in Freemasonry, that has set up the parent with $1 million a year business. Let's say this week's episode introduced a new badass Yu-Gi-Oh! Monster. The kid whose parents are wealthy will show up at school and start showing off a real-life Yu-Gi-Oh! Card of that latest powerful monster to his friends. That's because his parents are rich and spending money on that is chump change for them. This kid will then tell his poverty-stricken friend, "Oh, I bet you're jealous. I bet you wish you had this." This will inflict torment on the poverty-stricken kid due to his being of the lower caste and unable to afford the card. This can also incite depression. A kid might end up forcing himself to do chores or get a part-time job just to afford some bullshit Yu-Gi-Oh! Card, so his wealthier friends won't be looking down on him. So instead of just making all the cards available at a reasonable price that covers the cost of ink and paper and printing equipment, plus some profit so everyone can equally enjoy the game, it has to be structured such so the wealthy get to lord their prestige over the poor. Who but the tribe, ladies and gentlemen, would think up ideas like this? And who, except the members of the tribe, are all the rich people in this world who love flaunting their prestige and privilege and wealth? For example, Masons who were enriched through Freemasonry, especially the Mormon ones, because the Church of Mormon is run by Freemasonry, they are actually compelled, as part of being Masons, to spend their money on prestigious products produced by other Masonic businesses, even if they might not want or need them. They are compelled, probably by force. This is why you'll see a Masonic rich pig with a Bentley or a Ferrari just sitting in his garage, not even being driven. He bought it just to own it. But I'm guessing he also bought it because he was compelled to buy it. You see, you're not just made rich by the world-controlling cult for nothing in return. You might have to sacrifice a family member, and also spend your money on other Masonic businesses, whether you like it or not. See, it comes with all these stipulations where you have to employ Masonic businesses first, if you need a service. And you can only use Goy businesses when there isn't a Masonic business that's offering the product or service you need. Instead of doing useful Goyim jobs, such as service or labor jobs, it would be nice if I could just draw up fictitious monsters and make cards, then contrive it so the product is inflicting psychological damage on children, and make millions while some stupid Goy slave is doing labor work and can't afford rent. Almost all of us can invent fictitious Pokemon creatures in our heads, but we can't make money off it because the tribe controls the world's entertainment industries. So they get to control who gets to make millions of dollars off of fictitious animal drawings. What about microtransactions on Call of Duty? Same idea. Those create the same deleterious mental effect. Imagine one of your teenage friends basically wins one of the rare or legendary guns in that slot machine-like loot crate. Now this kid shows off his virtual prize to his friends. Perhaps this kid is rich and a member of the tribe, and he can afford to spend all the money he wants on supply drops. Now all the poorer kids near him will feel terrible about their condition, that their friend just shamed them for being poor, and they'll be agonizing that they can't afford supply drops because their parents can hardly afford to pay bills. The poor kid might beg his parents to spend money on some supply drops in hopes of getting a virtual gun. The parents will refuse the kid's request, castigating him for suggesting that they waste precious money on something so retarded. The kid will feel only worse, tormented between wishing to uphold his status before his peers and at the same time knowing that it's wrong to waste money on shit like that. Imagine if this kid is also autistic. Autism causes a fixation on things, sometimes very dumb things. If you are poor, your life is going to be boring as shit. You got no fucking vacations, nothing. You're probably being bullied at school. The fantasy world of a Yu-Gi-Oh card game or a Call of Duty game is the only thing that provides you with escape from a fucked up reality or a sense of control or power over something. And yet even these things have to remind you that you are poor, and your life sucks, and in the back of your mind you know these companies are scamming you and preying on you, but you can't help it. And they get to summon all this emotional torment with worthless shit that is either ink on cardboard or some virtual thing that you can only see on a fucking screen as pixels. It only gets worse. The media and even your school teachers start telling you that gender is an artificial construct and that you can be any gender you want to be. You just have to believe you are a different gender than what you were born to be. Now, there are some practical reasons for why you might want to assume, in your mind, the role of the opposite gender that have nothing to do with sexual reasons or mental illness or anything like that. For example, men are expected to work harder than women. Think about it. If there is some kind of a labor work, it almost always falls on the man's shoulders. Well, maybe you are a male teenager, and you have to do a lot of laborious chores, because that's what's expected of a man, especially if you are poor, and then you hear that being a different gender is all in your mind. You don't even have to have the surgery to change your genitalia. If you have a male body, but in your mind you are a female, that's all that matters. Society has to treat you as a female. You can choose to be a female right now. Start telling people you are one, and your biology doesn't matter. Well, if you want to get out of those labor-intensive chores, then just tell your parents that you feel like a woman. You were born a woman. You were born in the wrong body, and now they have to treat you the way they would treat a daughter. And you wouldn't make a fragile girl lug heavy things around, would you? So there you go, a practical reason to pretend you are a different gender, a scheme that will be reinforced by the media and the academia and even mental health professionals. Vice versa, if you are a woman and you are tired of men hogging all the glory, then just tell them you are a man in a woman's body, and maybe you too can go off and be a war hero. In a Zionism-driven war, of course. Hell, if anything, it's a good way to get into the public bathroom for the opposing sex, so as a boy, you can get to peek at girls in their underwear. Another thing is, every man might have some traits that can be considered feminine, and every woman might have some traits that can be considered masculine. That can create confusion because you can look at one minor feminine trait within yourself, if you are a man. Maybe you like the color pink or something. And it can be easy to take that as a notion that perhaps that's a sign you should actually live as a woman. If you decide you are the gender opposite what you are born with, then you have a moral standing to attack your parents as the bad guys because they raised you to be a man when they should have actually raised you to be a woman. They put all these burdens on you as their son that they wouldn't have put on their daughter. Therefore, they are assholes for determining your fate this way, and you should fight them. Bam! You got your Bolshevik destruction of the family unit concept being realized right there. There is a good practical application of the whole transgender idea. So kids can use that against their parents to control the parents. No wonder in my James Grider novel I labeled the tribe the Merchants of Mental Illness. It's an original label that I haven't heard anyone else use. How do you expect anyone to grow up psychologically wholesome in a reality like this? No wonder people are under depression, suicidal, on psychotropic medications, addicted to drugs or alcohol, and I haven't even scratched the surface with these examples. If only I could financially exploit children with a card game in such a way that the poor kids are made to feel terrible about being poor.